Good day, students. Welcome to mathgotserved.com. In this clip, we're going to be going over problems 6 to 10 of the Algebra 1 Common Core New York Regents exam for January 2015. All right, for number one, it reads, which domain would be the most appropriate set to use for a function that predicts the number of household online devices in terms of the number of people in the household? So we are creating a function here that determines the number of online devices as a function of the number of people in the household. So let's say we have this function f of n, the number of people in the household equals the number of online devices, okay? So the domain is the set of acceptable input values. So the question is, what is the acceptable set of numbers here for the domain n? Okay, the number of people in the household. All right, so we have integers, whole numbers, irrational numbers, rational numbers. Let's go over examples of each and what these numbers mean, and then see which one is an ideal candidate for the domain n, the number of people in the household. Let's start with integers. What are integers? Think about integers as whole numbers and their opposites. Okay, so negative 4, negative 3, negative 2, negative 1, 0, 1, 2, on and on. Okay, and then what are whole numbers? Whole numbers are positive integers. Okay, the subset of integers. So whole numbers, just think of whole numbers as 0, 1, 2, 3, on and on and on. Those are whole numbers. Irrational numbers are numbers that cannot be expressed as a quotient of two integers. You cannot express them as a fraction, okay? Examples of irrational numbers are square root of 3 or pi for the Euler number e. So numbers like this are irrational numbers, or non-terminating and non-repeating decimals, okay? All right, now there goes irrational numbers. Rational numbers are numbers that can be written as a quotient of two integers. For example, 2. 2 is a rational number because you can write it as 2 over 1, or 3 over 2, or terminating decimal 0.5, or repeating decimal 0.6. Okay, all these numbers can be expressed as a ratio, I'm sorry, as a quotient of two integers. Okay, now we're talking about people, okay? Which of these types of numbers can be used to describe, which of the sets can be used to describe the number of people in a household? Let's take a look at integer. In a set of integers, if we can just find one counterexample, one number that is inappropriate, then the whole set will be inappropriate. So can we have negative people in a household, like negative 2, for instance? The answer is no. So since you can't have negative people in a household, integers is not an appropriate set for this function, for the domain, okay? Whole numbers, can you have 0 people in a house? 1, 2, 3, absolutely. Answer is option number 2, whole numbers. If you look at irrational and rational numbers, you cannot have root 3 number of people in a household, makes no sense. Or half a person in a household, that makes absolutely no sense. Okay, so the only set of numbers that can represent number of people are whole numbers. All right, let's take a look at problem 7. It says the inequality 7 minus 2 over 3x is less than x minus 8 is equivalent to. This is just a fancy way to say solve this inequality. Now, solving inequalities is very similar to solving equations. The only difference is do not forget to reverse the symbol when you divide by negative. Okay, when you divide or multiply by negative, so that's something you do not want to forget. Don't forget to reverse the symbol when you divide by negative. That's the only difference, all right? So we have 7 minus 2 over 3x is less than x minus 8. I like my x's on the left side, so I am going to subtract x from both sides, and that yields 7 minus 2 over 3x minus x is less than negative 8. I'm going to proceed to subtract 7 from both sides of my equation because I want the x's on one side. So that yields negative 2 over 3x minus the coefficient of x is 1, so I can write it as 1 over 1x is less than. Now, since these two numbers have the same sign, you add and keep the sign. 8 plus 7 is 15, so you have negative 15. Okay? All right, let's combine these fractions on the left side. To do that, we'll need the LCD. The LCD of 3 and 1 is 3, so we need this denominator to be 3. To accomplish that, we'll multiply top and bottom by 3. So that yields negative 2 over 3x minus 3 over 3x is less than negative 15. Combine these two just by adding the numerator, you have negative 5 over 3x is less than negative 15. Okay, we're done when we have x isolated. So the last step is to multiply both sides by the reciprocal of the coefficient of x, negative 5 over 3. Its reciprocal is negative 3 over 5. Okay, multiply both sides by that, negative 3 over 5. So 5 divides here 1. Minus times a minus, slash and dash is a plus. 3 goes here 1. On the left side, we have x. So now, what did we talk about keeping in mind when you're dealing with inequalities? Anytime you multiply by negative, as we did here, the orientation of the inequality symbol reverses. So less than becomes greater than, okay? Now we can divide 5 divides 5 once. 5 goes into 15 3 times. Minus times minus is a plus, slash and dash. 3 times 3 is 9. Your final answer is x is greater than 9. So our answer is option number 1. All right, let's take a look at problem number 8. It reads the value in dollars v of x of a certain car after x years is represented by the equation v of x equals 25,000 times 0.86 to the x. To the nearest dollar, how much more is the car worth after 2 years than after 3 years? So if you look at this function we have here, since it's 0.86, this is a decay, radioact exponential decay situation. So the value of the car, as you would expect, is depreciating over time. Okay? So all we just have to do is find a value at 2 years, and then find a value at 3 years after 3 years, and then subtract the two. All right? So we're just going to find the what we're looking for is V of 2, the value after 2 years, minus V of 3, the value after 3 years. And that will tell us how much more the car is worth after 2 years than after 3 years. Okay? So V of 2, the value of the car after 2 years. How do we do that? Well, we have the function V of x equals 25,000 times 0.86 to the x. V of 2 simply means you substitute 2 for x in this function. So we have 25,000 times 0.86. Instead of x, you have 2. Okay? We'll let the calculator do the work here. And then V of 3, the same thing, but 25,000. We will replace the x with 3 this time. Okay? All right, so I'm going to be using a TI 83 plus calculator for a computation here. So first of all, let's do V of 2, 25, 1, 2, 3, times 0.86 raised to the second power. That's the value of the car after 2 years. After 3 years, I can just press second function enter to recall what I entered before. Scroll back, change that to 3, enter value of the car after 3 years. So all we just have to do is just subtract the two values, 18,490 value after 2 years minus 1,000, I'm sorry, 15,901.4. Before I compute that, let me write down my answers so we can keep track of what we're doing here. So V of 2 value after 2 years is 18,490, and in value after 3 years is 15,901.4. And then we're looking for difference in values, difference in values. That's basically 18,490 minus 15,901.4. Press enter. We have 2,588.6. So it's going to be 2,588.6, but we're rounding, we're asked to round to the nearest dollar. So if we round this to the nearest dollar, it would be 2,589. Okay, so our answer is option number one. So let's write that down. This is 2,589 to the nearest dollar. Okay, let's move on to the next problem. For problem 9, it says which has the same y-intercept as the graph below? So the y-intercept is basically where the graph intercepts the y-axis. Okay, the graph intercepts the y-axis right here. Your y-intercept is negative 3. Okay, the coordinate of that point is 0, comma, negative 3. Now, what do you notice about the coordinates of this point? You see, the x coordinate is 0. That is how you find the y-intercept. Okay, so let's write that down. That's really important. To find the y-intercept, set x to 0. That's how you find the y-intercept. Okay, so that's what we're going to use to solve this problem. We're going to ask ourselves which of these satisfy this equation, 0, negative 3. Okay, when I plug in 0, negative 3 into any these equations, which of them generates a true statement? Whichever one generates a true statement, that will be our correct answer. So let's start with option one. To get the y-intercept, it's going to be 12 minus 6 times what? Set x to 0 over 4. That's how you find your y-intercept. So let's simplify this. Our y-intercept, 6 times 0 is just 0. Y-intercept is 12 over 4, which is 3. Is that what we want? The answer is no. We need negative 3. Okay. All right, let's take a look at option 2. 27 plus 3. We want to find a y-intercept. To get the y-intercept, we set x to 0. Okay, so we have 27 plus 3 times the y-intercept equals 0. Subtract 27 from both sides. And then we have, what do we have? We have, the 27 just add up to 0. So we have 3 times the y-intercept equals negative 27. And then we divide both sides by 3 to get our y-intercept. And then we have our y-intercept equals negative 27 over 3 is negative 9. Is that what we want? Nope, we need negative 3. So option 2 is incorrect. Now let's move on to option 3. Option 3, we have 6 times the y-intercept. To get the y-intercept, what happens to x? X is set to 0 equals 18. So we have 6 times the y-intercept equals 18. To get y by itself, we simply divide both sides by 6. So our y-intercept is what? Y-intercept is 3. Is that what we want? Nope, we need negative 3. So by elimination, our correct answer should be option 4. Okay, so let's go ahead and work it out just to make sure. So option 4, we have our y-intercept. A y-intercept plus 3 equals 6x. Actually, since we're looking for the y-intercept, instead of 6x, we should have 6 times 0 because x attains a value of 0 when we have the y-intercept, okay? So we have the y-intercept plus 3 is equal to 6 times 0, which is 0. We'll subtract 3 from both sides. And then we'll have a y-intercept with a value of negative 3. And that is exactly what we want. So option number 4 is our correct answer. Option number 4. All right, let's take a look at problem number 10. It says Fred is given a rectangular piece of paper. If the length of Fred's piece of paper is represented by 2x minus 6, and the width is represented by 3x minus 5, then the paper has a total area represented by. So let's give ourselves a visual of this situation. Have a rectangular piece of paper, okay? And you have your length of 2x minus 6 and the width of 3x minus 5. And we're looking for the area. What's the formula of for the area of a rectangle? Is length times width, okay? So that's what we're going to be applying here. Our area is length times width. So when we substitute the algebraic expressions for the values of length and width, we will have 2x minus 6 times 3x minus 5. So this problem is basically assessing your ability to expand binomial products, okay? So let's go ahead and do this. Distribute twice. First, outer, inner, last. Okay? Okay, so let's go ahead and distribute this. 2x times 3x is 6x squared. 2x times negative 5 is negative 10x. Negative 6x times positive 3x is negative 18x. And then negative 6 times negative 5, minus times minus is a plus. 6 times 5 is 30. Okay? Middle terms are like terms, so we combine both of them. So we'll get the area having the value of the expression 3x squared minus 28x plus 30. So that's the expression for the area of our rectangle. Answer is option number 2. Thanks so much for taking the time to watch this presentation. We really appreciate it. If you like this presentation and you would like us to continue, go ahead and give us a thumbs up. If we get enough thumbs up, then we'll be encouraged to continue making the remainder of this review series. And do not forget to subscribe to our channel so that when we make the next installment, you get instantaneous update. More clips can be found on mathgotserved.com under test prep. Thanks again for watching and have a wonderful day.